Ông quý chủ. Ông chủ nhiệm ban cam tổ cái tham luận cao này tiếp thị tham luận cao ในมณฑลปราวิทยาจุนเตอร์กรมเมจิบีการพิการในนุนเชียบรรโตกาตังสมรุนในดาวจิปุอเนจิมเนียงองจิมเรศสมสู่เตอร์เมจิบีการพิการในลงนุนเชียลงไปเจอกุเปธาเอกซาดีปีร้อยหกสิบบุญสละพรามจุนมุ้ยได้ลูกเลือกลางน้องบ่มนองเธอจิมลุธานองกาตังสมนัวในดาวจิปุเนจิมเนียงนี่ตาบานดะโจลนึกน้องสนมเรืองไฮเรนเนอ
no, we haven't, but we will.
This
is the wrong sequence of events.
An article from a book of
Keenan.
The part on East Timor obviously is less relevant, but this particular article, when it comes to especially this page from that article, we believe is highly relevant, and therefore we request
at least
one sentence on why not earlier.
It's a very good question. We could have done it early, but sometimes when you reread things, you just stumble upon it.
We could have done it early, I agree, but in the preparation of today's witness,
I reread it and
so on. Yeah.
เป็นทางเป็นยาเราอันตรายเมียนมาเตยบอลอย่างเมื่อกี้เลยสำนักสมกาได้เอกสารอันใหม่นี่ดีปีโดยเขาสมบูรณ์สลักประจำจุดมุ้ยชี้เอกสารพอตั้งสมัยเจมูธานตั้งตำรวจเอ็นดาวจิบัวเนี่ยจำเรียนยุคนี้
Your Honour, it's a large book, so we haven't had an opportunity to review the book.
But my concern more is with the relevance of the question
what United States and Indonesia's view of Vietnam's ambitions are, how relevant it is for this witness. This witness has been asked to testify on the treatment of
God man, I think God man,
the question, if it relates to what you just mentioned, I think it's beyond his expertise, and I think it's beyond the relevance of the reason why you asked this expert to come.
The next session we'll be talking about foreign policy. ហើយ សំណួរបន្ទាប់នេះគឺសួរពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងទស្សនៈអន្តរជាតិចំពោះប្រទេសវៀតណាមសភុនឹងគឺតែជាសភុមួយដែលផ្ដល់ការផ្ដល់ព័ត៌មាននឹងចំណេះដឹងយ៉ាងច្រើនប៉ុន្តែខ្ញុំក៏សង្កល់ឃើញថាសំណួរភាគច្រើននេះគឺថាមិនពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងភាសាអង់គ្លេសដែលទៅសួររូបគាត់នោះទេ
If I may respond,
ខ្ញុំសូមឆ្លើយតបលោកប្រធាន
សូមជួយក្រុមថាមិវិនាំមុខតំណាងដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋបព្វនី
អឺ
Merci.
Merci, Monsieur le...
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Bonjour à tous.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Le document est admis, en fait.
J'aimerais donner à la Défense le numéro.
C'est E3-96-86. Le problème est simplement que le document n'a pas été inclus dans la liste à transmettre à M. l'expert. Et qui n'a pas été inclus dans l'interface, ce qui n'a pas permis aux parties d'en prendre connaissance en temps et en heure. Donc E3-96-86, je m'associe complètement aux observations du procureur sur la pertinence des questions qui ont été posées depuis une demi-heure environ. Nous pensons que les questions posées par notre confrère Copé sortent complètement du champ d'expertise de l'expert et du champ de la décision E3-88 par laquelle la Chambre a proposé cet expert. Donc nous appelons la Chambre à la plus grande vigilance pour que les questions posées soient pertinentes et en lien avec la compétence de l'expert qui est un anthropologue. Nous avons entendu notre confrère Copé le dire pendant une journée et demie que l'expert était anthropologue et qu'il fallait qu'il reste dans son domaine de compétences. Et nous retournons la faveur à notre confrère aujourd'hui et nous nous devrons à chaque fois que nous avons l'impression que les questions qu'il pose sortent du domaine de compétences de l'expert. Merci.
Let me start first by thanking you very much. Civil parties for saying that it is actually already in the case file. We haven't noticed that, so that makes it all easier. I was actually about to introduce my questions by indicating as to why I was asking my questions.
Mr.
Hinton, without actually saying so into a new chapter of my questions, we believe that the perception of the UK and the rest of the world of Vietnam's foreign policy is intrinsically linked to the treatment of the Vietnamese.
We cannot understand
certain things in contemporaneous documents if you do not understand Vietnam being the external enemy,
Vietnam
is
incredibly
important to have a full understanding as to how we should see the alleged treatment of Vietnamese. One cannot be seen without Vietnam. That's why I'm focusing my questions now on Vietnam as the external enemy, and then we'll move slowly into those within the CPK assisting Vietnam being perceived as the internal
enemies.
And from that
forward,
Cambodia,
I think we have said it before. I trust this expert is able to say However, let me move to my question. Before I move to that question as to how Vietnam's foreign policy was seen, my team has just informed me that there is in fact a video of a speech of late King Father speech probably in the early 80s, in which he literally
addresses Vietnam.
Chom tae mdaong tha samdau to leu prateh Vietnam tha a
yun
hai priep thiep yun ni doy krapoe
chang ne
chi chomho muoy dae yeung khom snak oy som mean ka
banchea team members are saying
samachit khmae ka samachit robos yeung khnyom chi
bokolot khmae.
No, it's not on the case file.
Not on the case file, and as you said, the court is in no position to verify what you're saying.
If it's not on the case file,
bien, je ne vais pas commenter sur les documents qui ne sont pas au dossier, mais je reviens sur le document dont vous entendez faire usage, et apparemment, le document qui est sous la cote E3-96-86 ne contient que 6 pages, pas la page 105, donc apparemment, vous entendez faire usage. Donc, apparemment, ce document n'est pas dans son entièreté un document qui a été versé au dossier.
มันត្រូវបានដាក់ចូលក្នុងសំណុំរឿងទេដាក់តែប្រមាណទំព័រតែប៉ុណ្ណោះដូច្នេះបើលោកចង់ប្រើប្រាស់ឯកសារនេះលោកត្រូវធ្វើសំណើខ្ញុំមិនដឹងថាតើភាគីជំទាស់ឬក៏យ៉ាងម៉េចទេ
ចឹង
បញ្ហាវាមានពីរបញ្ហាពាក់ព័ន្ធនៃចំនួនរបស់លោកនិងបញ្ហានៃការទទួលយកឯកសារមួយនេះ
ចឹងខ្ញុំមិនដឹងថាតើភាគី
ផ្សេងទៀតចង់ជំទាស់ទៅនឹងការដាក់បញ្ចូលឯកសារនេះទៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿងឬក៏យ៉ាងម៉េច
So your honor,
សាប្រញ្ញារងអន្តរជាតិលោកស្រីយ៉ៅក្រុមយើងខ្ញុំបានដឹងថាវានៅក្នុងសំណុំរឿងហើយលោកស្រីយ៉ៅក្រុមដើម្បីឲ្យកិច្ចដំណើរការនីតិវិធីដំណើរការទៅក្នុងលក្ខណៈមួយត្រឹមត្រូវ
ពេល
មេធាវីកាពីក្តីត្រូវតែលើកយកឯកសារណាមួយដែលមិនប្រឈមទៅនឹងការជំទាស់ដោយសារថាមិនទាំងបានដាក់នៅលើ interface ផង
In the way it was pitched in terms of the question that was to be used, we think it's of minimal relevance. So important to the defense, they should have placed the document on the case file a lot earlier. And this witness has been scheduled to testify for a long time. And I think that the order of the case file in the court has not been predictable. I don't think you can say that this document should be...
ខ្ញុំយល់ឃើញថាឯកសារអង្គជំនុំជម្រះមិនគួរទទួលយកឯកសារនោះទេ
មេធាវីកាពីក្តីនៅក្នុង
សំណុំរឿងតាំងពីខែមីនា2010មកម្លេះ
It doesn't have an E3 number
ឯកសារនេះមាន E3 ទេ
It's only a few sentences
ដោយសារតែឯកសារនេះមានតែ 3-4 ប្រយោគហើយខ្ញុំបានស្នើសុំឲ្យអ្នកជំនាញពិនិត្យមើលនៅពេលជប់សម្រាប់ហើយខ្ញុំយល់ឃើញថាវាមានការជាប់ពាក់ព័ន្ធដោយសារវាជាប់ពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងជំហររបស់កម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យតាក់ទងទៅនឹងគោលនយោបាយរបស់វៀតណាមមកលើកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ
្យ
ហើយមែនសម្រាប់តែការយល់ឃើញរបស់កម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យទេក៏ប៉ុន្តែក៏វាជាការយល់ឃើញទៅលើទស្សនៈមហិច្ឆតារបស់វៀតណាមនិងសូវៀត
មកលើកម្ពុជាដូច្នេះខ្ញុំសូមរំលឹកទៅដល់អង្គជំនុំជម្រះថាខ្ញុំបានចាប់ដើម
សូមអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យខ្ញុំសួរសំណួរនេះសិនហើយគឺដែលខ្ញុំនឹងផ្ដល់លេខឯកសារនេះជូន
មកទៅ
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Bonjour à tous. Simplement, peut-être
en guise d'observation dans le cadre de votre délibération. C'est vrai que le 87-4, lorsque on prépare un témoin, notamment un témoin expert, on ne pense pas forcément longtemps à l'avance. Je rappelle que Monsieur Hinton a été programmé il y a un mois seulement, et que dans la mesure où c'est un expert, et que c'est un document qui est en rapport avec un auteur Kiernan que l'expert lui-même a indiqué bien connaître et sur lequel il a travaillé dans le cadre de ses travaux. Je pense qu'il ne devrait pas avoir de critique sur l'utilisation de ce document. Monsieur le Président,
មានបញ្ហាអីទេលោកមិនបើកបិទកោពេលឥឡូវនិយាយអស់មកប៉ុន្តែលោកមិនតន់អាចតាំងសំណួរអ្វីបានទេលោកដោះស្រាយបញ្ហាឯកសារនេះជាមុនស្អាតបានច្បាស់លាស់សិនបានអនុញ្ញាតតលប្រធានអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យលោកទៅមុខទៀតបានលោកអាចទៅបាន
No problem at all, Mr. President, because I have plenty of other documents
ដែលប្រសិទ្ធអាចសារក្នុងសំណុំរឿងនៃប្រទេសកម្ពុជាដែលទៅប្រទេសជិតខាងនេះក៏យល់ឃើញអំពីមហិច្ឆតារបស់វៀតណាមមកលើកម្ពុជាដែរឥឡូវទុកឯកសារនឹងមើលលើខ្ញុំសួរលោកថាតើលោកស្គាល់ឈ្មោះតេងសៅពេញទេអញ្ជើញលោកសាភិយារងអន្តរជាតិ
Mr. President, I would just like to make a general point at this stage. Throughout this morning, the Council has been making statements about facts and then presenting another question to the expert. Giving a small speech about other people using it and what's on the case file and what proves and what it doesn't prove. I don't think it's appropriate. I think counsel should just ask the witness a question but not give speeches. This has happened a number of times today. I would just like to make that question now. Sometimes it's a background, but certainly not to make
វិជ្ជាការពុតហើយគាត់លើកឡើងអំពីប្រវត្តិសាស្ត្រដើមមួយចំនួនមិនខុសទេក៏ប៉ុន្តែសួរសំណួរសិនទៅនេះគឺជាការសំគាល់របស់ខ្ញុំតែប៉ុណ្ណោះ
Thank you very much for this observation but my question was
any
objection whether Mr. Hinton knows who Deng Xiaoping
ជំទាស់នៅឡើយទេអញ្ចឹងខ្ញុំសួរឡើងវិញលោកអ្នកជំនាញស្គាល់ឈ្មោះតេងសៀវពីងទេ
Thank you, Mr. Co-Defense Lawyer. Yes, I do. I just want to also add in a point of clarification and a couple of regards. In terms of the discussions that have been taking place about my research, going back to a comment that you made, Mr. Co-Defense Lawyer, about Deng Kiernan being supportive of my work, if you open up and look at the preface of my book, I cite many scholars, David Chandler, Mavie Hara, Judy Ledgerwood, John Marston. There are literally dozens of scholars, I think. And this sort of movement of saying there's sort of Ben Kiernan, myself, David Chandler, really reduces the number of scholars who've worked in this area, and the number of scholars in particular that inform my research. You know, there are many different people. We've mentioned Nayan Chanda, Chuang Notebooks, CPK Notebooks, Radio Broadcast. There's work of people like David Hawk, Hinton, who worked in the 1980s on the charge of genocide, Greg Stanton, Craig Etchinson, Steve Hedder, who you mentioned, Michael Vickery, who you mentioned, court transcripts, the list goes on in terms of anthropologists, Mavie Hara, who worked in a village and has done work on the lived experience of DK. The list is extensive, John Marston. So I think in terms of trying to understand the DK period and what happened, it's important in relationship to my work to understand that I've been influenced by a wide range of people, a number of documents, and I don't want it to be reduced down to this very narrow vision of who an influence is on my scholarship. The other thing, people have been, there's a way of talking, an anthropologist. I tried to explain that an anthropologist is concerned with lived experience, but also needs to be holistic and learns about multiple fields. Nowadays, in terms of scholarship, many scholars operate in a number of different interdisciplinary fields. And so, you know, I'm happy with the focused question. to try and see if I can answer. We actually, you know, if you ask a specific question, that would be good. So I just want to make those two sort of points of clarification, just so we don't have these sort of reductive images of what an anthropologist is, and also the number of scholars with whom I'm interacted. I think if the translation was correct, it was said that I'm a close friend of Thich Nhat Hanh, and I'm a colleague of Thich Nhat Hanh. I think I may have had lunch with him once when I gave a talk at Yale. I don't think I've ever talked to him on the telephone, for example. So I think we need to be careful about making reductive statements about influences and recognize that as a scholar, I've drawn on a number of different sources and coming to my conclusions, and that as an anthropologist, I do my best, for example, to understand foreign policy and certainly in relationship to seeking the truth, you know, and trying to understand the relationship of U.S. foreign policy in relationship to Vietnam, and also the logic of the CPK leadership. I think for understanding the truth, that's absolutely important. But I would just request that, as opposed to piecemeal sort of selective questions, you know, a good focused question, and I can tell you whether or not I can respond broadly to the point. I was happy to respond to the other document, but no, it's not admissible, but if you have another document, I'm happy to proceed.
Before I return to my Deng Xiaoping question, brought it up, I'm happy to be to be a bit honest as to why I'm focused on Chandler and Keen, because when I read your book, it was as if I was reading Keen or Chandler. Let me give you an example. In one chapter, or one or two chapters, you use the word paranoia with Pol Pot, paranoia with the party center, paranoia
about
real and perceived enemies.
As I said before, yes, I do, but I'd like to also respond that in terms of the scholarship, I don't think that it's just Bin Kiernan and David Chandler who speak this way. It's many different people. In terms of the relationship and the use of the word paranoia, there's some people who bandy it about, but I actually embed my discussion of paranoia and relationship to local cultural understandings and do it in a very different way. I think can talk about building paranoia in the CPK leadership. Will it proceed to something that a large body of scholarship, most of the scholars I read, support in their conclusions? I don't think it's very reductive of the scholarship to imply that it's simply two people. I also think that it's important to look, for example, at the work of Cambodians and the Documentation Center of Cambodia, who I've mentioned before, who also have done extensive research now. So again, I think to try and understand the DCA regime solely through these two lenses, as if that's the scholarship, you know, is a reduction. I also think that it's to say that they're exactly the same. Earlier, you implied that there were significant differences between the two, if I understood you correctly.
Maybe we should have this discussion. I'll get back to the paranoia and receive the data later. Again, Deng Xiaoping, who was he? And do you know what he... China's position was on Vietnam's policy to Vietnam,
Yes, and in terms of policy of China during the DK regime was to support CPK largely and to contain Vietnam.
Deng Xiaoping once called Vietnam the hooligans of the East. In your expert opinion, being someone who
Thank you, Mr. Co-Defense Lawyer. You know, so we don't have a context for the question. Maybe provide more context and also maybe say what your opinion is, and I could say whether or not I'm able to, you know, give my affirmation if that seems reasonable or not. But I think in terms of a series of decontextualized questions, it's very hard to proceed. You yourself tried to say that what I was supposed to speak about was my book and the research in my book predominantly, and my field, ethnographic field of research from 1994 to 1995. And when I spoke outside of that purview to talk about my subsequent research, I was told not to talk about it. Now you seem to be telling me that I should speak about all sorts of different things that are outside of this domain. I'm happy to try and assist the process as an expert witness and answer questions, but it seems that you have a contradiction in the sorts of things that you're asking me about. And also, when I received information from the prosecution, co-prosecutors, and from the civil party lawyers, they asked specific questions related to documents. I have a binder full of documents which I refer very readily. I don't have those. Instead, I'm getting fragments of information that are decontextualized, some of which I'm being shown for the first time during breaks. Again, I very much want you to be able to express the views of the defense about these issues, and I would like to assist and help in that, but I need more specific context and more order. And again, I note this contradiction that on the one hand, when it's suitable, I'm just, quote unquote, just an anthropologist, but then at other times I'm supposed to be a foreign policy expert. I think the purview of my competence is interdisciplinary as a genocide scholar. But again, I think that, you know, you can't have it both ways.
But last point, I fully agree. Let me read you the document that you actually...
Your Honor, I think the witness has given the answer, and that the questions by counsel need to be very specific and relevant to the statements of the trial. And secure questions. Are putting this expert in a very difficult position. So we'd ask that counsel focus on treatment of the S21 and any directly related questions about that
disorder.
And also, because documents are not in front of this expert, if counsel give a specific document and asked to comment on them, then the expert needs to
come to the expert support. I was about to do that. There is a document that was provided to Mr. Hinton. It's E3/73-25. It's a report. January 1979, the Standing Committee member of the Chinese Communist Party. In our view, represents Chinese views on Vietnam. Vietnam, thing to understand DK's policy when it comes to Vietnam. The French I will provide a bit later, to leave, Mr. President. It says the following. In 1973, in order to remind the Cambodian leaders to maintain constant vigilance, Chairman Mao also told Sihanouk that Ho Chi Minh had talked with Chairman Mao about the establishment of the Indochina Federation. After 1974, Vietnamese troops coordinated with the revolutionary forces of Cambodia in various battles in Cambodia. Vietnam seized this opportunity to cultivate a group of pro-Vietnam Cambodian leaders.
The seat of disaster was thus sown.
A little bit before, as a matter of fact, as early as before the liberation of South Vietnam, Vietnam had harbored malicious intentions. A small handful of its war maniacs at the instigation of their social imperialist behind the scenes boss had wanted to encroach in Cambodia, drawing it into the so-called Indochina alliance and turning it into the springboard and base of social imperialism. This, we believe, represents the official Chinese view on Vietnam. This, we believe, was shared by the American administration in
75.
Yesterday we spoke about the word Yun, whether that refers to Vietnamese or whether that refers to Vietnam. In the light of that word, also used in the revolutionary flags, the document that was shown to you yesterday or read out to you yesterday, what is your reaction to these Chinese perceptions of Vietnam's foreign policy toward
Cambodia?
Thank you, Mr. Co-Defense Lawyer. I believe that those perceptions may well have been the perceptions of the leadership, and certainly yours have been a fear of the CPK leadership.
You have been called to testify specifically in relation to the treatment of Vietnamese people in the UK. You said all kinds of things yesterday about Vietnamese. They were all killed, as you said. My question to you is, if you can say something from an anthropological view, how DK's perception of Vietnam's ambitions
was
treatment of Vietnamese citizens?
Again, it would be useful to have specific documents at hand. We've seen a number introduced, so I the point that indeed I think the CPK leadership had fears about Vietnam, and I think part of these fears became manifest through a discourse of incitement, strong, vehement, racist, anti-Vietnamese, and anti-Vietnam discourse. But as I said before, the word UN is a diffuse word, right? So it referred to ethnic Vietnamese in Cambodia as well as to people from Vietnam, to both groups. So it's a word that's used and has a double valence.
But now we're actually getting to the point that I'm trying to get at. You always seem to be saying DK had fears. DK had a perception of an enemy. Enemies were perceived, sometimes real, mostly perceived.
Everybody was paranoid.
Countries like China, Indonesia, United States, there was a real threat this blatant act of aggression, the invasion of
1979. Thank you, Mr. Co-Defense Lawyer.
While
there are elements of truth to what you're saying, need to be acknowledged, I think that you can't simply make a singular statement that covers the entire DK period. As I said before, there's a temporal flow, and you yourself invoke the work of Michael Vickery, who has emphasized the need to think about temporal variation. So to simply take something to decontextualize it erases the nuance of the historical flow. In terms of the rhetoric about Vietnam and about, as the word is used, Yuen that appears. As I said before, if you look at the enemies of the state, you have a change. And again, this came out if you look at the enemies that were perceived at S-21. It's very evident. You go back to M-13, as I said before, you have people who are thought to be Lon Nol spies who are being brought in. There's a little bit of purging, internal purging that's going on. It shifts. The Khmer Republic is targeted. Part in the next phase, then it goes on and it begins, especially after March 1976, to focus much more on internal enemies. And you have the beginning of large-scale purges, as you're well aware, as you begin to have towards, especially accentuated and becoming much more prevalent in the CPK discourse, to focus on Vietnam. And on Yuen, one that as the war escalates into 1978, becomes more and more, becomes a stronger and stronger strand. But it's important to know that from the very beginning, the word Yuen, traces of it can be found, but it definitely increased in vehemence through time. But as I said before, if you look at the course of the genocide against the ethnic Cham, and you look at the course of the genocide against ethnic Vietnamese, the element of racism was there from the beginning, even as the public expression of it, again, if you look at the volume of it, was stronger in 1978 than it was, for example, in 1975. Having said that, the concerns being real, I believe that the leaders of CPK believe that the threat was real, and they reacted accordingly. Whether or not to say that the fact of the January Vietnam invasion, Vietnamese-backed invasion at that point in time, the fact of it taking place, you can't simply say, oh, the threats were reasonable the entire time. It's a historical process. You mentioned, again, you know, we talked, well, I mentioned before Nayan Tanda's work. He talks about you have Khmer Rouge DK forces going into Vietnam and committing all sorts of atrocities. He went to villages. So there was also a provocation that played into this process. But, so to lead up to the events of early January, where the PRK regime eventually was formed, you have to look at the larger historical context. You can't look at the DK regime as passive. They are actors. And there's another dimension of it, which is that to say that there's a felt threat of an external enemy is one dimension, but there's also a felt threat of internal enemies, and you constantly get that. Internal enemies growing from within. There may be agents of, you know, CIA, KGB, Vietnam, what have you.
Let me stop you there. I apologize. But in your answer, although very long, I'm not quite sure if you answered my question, but again, I hear you saying that sure they thought there was a threat, or they perceived, they perceived it to be a threat. The reason I was putting the historical context to you before is that these fears were genuine, and were perceived by everybody who knew at the time, that it isn't some form of paranoia. And it only in understanding the revolutionary flag. So, my question again is, and that's I think what most scholars seem to be doing is minimizing the threat of Vietnam. And let me put it a bit further.
Yesterday, I think about four or five times, you made a comparison
to Nazi Germany. You said yourself that you are an expert on propaganda.
đòi thà thà lúc có chia đại chấm đen mũi bẹp bòn từ lần ăn tập bòn khâu sna nè địa phòng đây
between on the one hand
vì miền lạc là khó khăn như vậy lăng ở viên Nazi Alamong
Jews chủng
po chuyên chuyên chú ý
as opposed to
hai cái bàn bật bật lớn chuyên chuyên chú ý
Vietnam saw how DK saw Vietnam and how
tam robiet nu hai ko pon tae sanuk khom su tha ta
ultimately treated its citizens its Vietnamese citizens
ta Kampuchea prachea tapatai yul khoe yang doy mdaich chompu Vietnam hai ta Vietnam praprut yang doy mdaich dai mo leu Kampuchea ko doy che mo leu prachea chun robos prate ni.
Thank you, Mr. Co-defense lawyer.
I think
you raise a very interesting point, an important point, and it's one that I tried to convey in the very first session when I began to speak about Raphael Lemkin and the origins of the word genocide. Part of what I was attempting to do at that time, now that you've raised the issue again, is to trace the evolution of the word, how it began, and how it emerged in the aftermath of what is now called the Holocaust. And I say what is now called the Holocaust is because if you go back to Nuremberg, of course, that wasn't the term that was being used. It was crimes of aggression, crimes of peace that were being crimes against humanity. Those were things that were being talked about, even as being introduced. What's happened is in common discourse, and I think if I remember the testimony of Philip Short, this is a good example, but people have a discourse way of saying, well, genocide is what happened in the Holocaust. Well, if it looks like the Holocaust, it's genocide. If it doesn't look like the Holocaust, it's not genocide. That perception, that common perception and that argument is not showing an understanding of genocide studies, the field of genocide studies, and the scholarship that's been done, the ways in which the definition's been unpacked and looked at in different ways, looking at the 1946 resolution that was passed that included political groups at that point in time, was open to looking at economic group and social groups. It decontextualizes and dehistoricizes, and even the nuance of the debates at the UN about the word genocide at this time, right? These terms, what is a national group? Should we include cultural genocide as an issue? These were all debated and emerged as a historical product at a moment in time. But again, to think, oh, something is like or not like the Holocaust, therefore it is or is not genocide, is a misput way of framing it, even from the terms of the Genocide Convention. Having said that, I'd like to note that, as I said before, I've traced out a process of what I call genocidal priming and genocidal activation. Right? So we go through a series of states, as in the DK regime, as in Nazi Germany, you had a state of socioeconomic upheaval. You had, again, a process by which difference was manufactured, where you had pre-existing divisions that were crystallized over time, you had the marking of difference, you had the reorganization of society, so that the people who were being targeted, and an obvious example, one of those is the rounding up of Jews, placement in concentration camps, regulation, a bureaucracy of control, a targeting of these groups, and then once they're stigmatized, disempowered, and a gradual elimination of the groups that have been targeted in whole or in part. That process itself is a direct parallel in a process and a dynamic that occurs in a number of genocides. It's one that occurs during the DK regime. It's one that occurred during the Holocaust. Having said that, as I mentioned before, had I been able to go into length about the origins of the word genocide and the way we think about it, there are other sorts of genocides that take place, for example, and genocides against indigenous peoples in different places. But again, it's important not to simply say, oh, you know, do we have Auschwitz? Although some people link tool slang to Auschwitz as a metaphor, it's to look at what the understanding of genocide is, what the dynamics of genocide are, and then to look to see if the processes are similar. Based on my research, it seems clear that this is a case of genocide, both on the basis of the 1946 resolution, on the basis of the UN Genocide Convention, on the basis of a wide body of scholarship that allows attention to a wide range of groups, from all in all those different ways, it's a genocide.
I find the comparison very unpractical, but that's the reason that I referred to it is because you kept bringing it up yesterday. But let me, now that we're on the subject, make a step aside and ask you, with one or, with two or three examples, whether you believe as a genocide scholar
that these mass
killings or mass deportations or mass confinements are also can also be qualified as genocide.
Can we give you
the mass internment of Japanese people in 1941 and subsequently in the United States,
dehumanizing and genocide, do you consider that to be a genocide as well, or excide?
Thank you, Mr. Co-Defense Lawyer. Again, it depends on what definition you use to begin to make a determination of whether or not this would or would not be a genocide. So are you using the UN Genocide Convention? Are you using Helen Fine's definition? Are you using Israel Charney's definition? It depends. First of all, the first thing you need to do is have your methodological definition, and then your conclusions proceed from there.
Let me interrupt you. I believe with your opinions is that the word genocide is all over the place. It is mass killings, my question to you said you are a genocide scholar. The mass internment of Japanese citizens in 1941, dehumanizing the context of the social, economic upheaval in the war, etc. Was that an act of genocide in the U.S.?
I have
no objection to the question, but the point I raised earlier, the critiquing and criticizing of the expert he's mischaracterizing the expert mischaracterizing his position.
And then asking him a question,
that's just not appropriate. It's a reasonable question. You should just ask the question about how many speech every time you proceed with the question.
Fine, no problem, I'll just ask the question. In your expert opinion, the treatment of Japanese in the U.S. in 1941 and subsequently,
Thank you, Mr. Co-Defense Lawyer. You raise a very interesting question, one that deserves further study. I'm not an expert on Japanese internment, though I know something about it. Again, one of the mistakes that's frequently made is people bring up a random case about which not a lot is known, or they may not know a lot, and they begin to make pronouncements about whether something is or is not genocide. In the corpus of literature that exists within the field of genocide studies, you will find virtually very little or no mention of this case, which, again, does not mean that it should be taken up and considered, but you need to do in-depth research along the lines of the research I've done on the DK period and on a number of other genocides. Having said that, if you look at the process of genocidal priming, as I mentioned before, where you have groups in a situation of upheaval, which is taking place at the time, you have groups which begin to be marked and also organized, you see the potential of a genocidal process being activated. So if I had to give you a quick answer with the caveat that to give you a full, accurate answer, I would need to do more research and become an expert on this area. I would say that you have a situation that's lukewarm, right, in terms, if we think of this metaphor of heat, but as I said before, there's also a process of genocidal activation. That process is not present. So we get to a situation where you have the potential for genocide, but in fact not a case of genocide. But again, I would put the caveat that for all of us, you know, we want to do in-depth research on a case. And this isn't a case that is discussed widely within the field of genocide studies. It's one that's mentioned. It's one that deserves further study.
Let me move on and give you a second example. Deportation, massive deportation of Vietnamese people of Chinese origin,
mostly Chinese origin,
the Socialist Republic of Vietnam, leading to hundreds of thousands of boat refugees,
massive deaths of those people,
would you consider that to be genocide?
Again, as opposed to doing a simple with not having a massive body of knowledge and doing in-depth study, as all of us should do, this again is not a case that's within the canon and the focus of study of the field of genocide studies. So I'd like to do, before giving a pronouncement, I would like to do lots more research. But once again, I would say based on what I do know, that again, if you look at the process of genocidal priming, you again have a situation that perhaps is lukewarm, but there's not activation. But again, it would be superfluous to simply throw out as an arbiter of truth, yes or no, without in-depth study. As I said before, with regard to DK regime, I've done extensive research, in-depth research. It's clear that it's a case of genocide. It's a conclusion that's supported within the field of genocide studies by many others as a case of genocide studies. So going back to the topic at hand, which is DK,
there wasn't any genocide. But let me give you a third example, an example which probably had the most effect on Cambodia, probably had a deep impact on strategy, tactics of the DK, of mass killings very close to Cambodia. The 1965 massive killings, about half a million in a few months, Indonesian communists by the regime of Suharto, apparently backed by CIA and American authorities. Was that a genocide?
Thank you, Mr. Co-Defense Lawyer. That case is much more discussed within the field of genocide studies, especially given the intent of the 1946 resolution, which included political groups. That case is within the field considered a case of genocide.
And subsequently, using that same reasoning, and I believe you said this, the treatment of the Vietnamese by the Long Nol public would amount to acts of genocide as well.
Thank you, Mr. Co-Defense Lawyer. I believe what I said is that we need to study this period much more, but that it's quite possible that this was a genocide. But again, with the need to study moments of history that are understudied, we don't have enough knowledge about to make a considered answer, we would need to study more, but I think the possibility, that is certainly a possibility.
Example of mass killings very close by, supported by again United States, mass killings in East Timor, 1975.
Thank you, Mr. Co-Defense Lawyer. Again, you know, within the field of genocide studies, this is a case that's often discussed as genocide.
Now a bit clearer as to what you the internal enemies, the president, the 30s, so maybe this is a good time.
Oui, Monsieur le Président, très brièvement. Je voudrais que on profite de la pause pour remettre un classeur avec quelques documents à
Monsieur l'expert,
sachant que ce sont des documents qui normalement ont été fournis, si j'ai bien compris, par la Chambre, mais comme le signe que je me réfère dans le cadre de mon interrogatoire, à l'attention des parties et de la Chambre, il s'agit des documents E3-123.
Professor Hinton, do you have access to these documents? Did you note that down now? Because I think the idea is for you to read it. Oh, I see. Okay.
បាទឥឡូវនេះដល់ពេលសម្រាប់ថ្ងៃត្រង់ហើយអរិយប្រកាសសម្រាប់ចាប់ពីនេះតទៅរហូតដល់ម៉ោង 1 កន្លះរសៀលនេះសូមអញ្ជើញចូលវិញដើម្បីបន្តកិច្ចសម្ការសម្រាប់ការមន្ត្រីរដ្ឋបាលតុលាការក្រុមរួមប្រដកន្លែងសម្រាប់នៅបន្ទប់រងចាំមិញមាប់សាក់សីដល់សាក់សីអ្នកជំនាញរូបនេះនៅក្នុងឡុងពេលជួបសម្រាប់នឹងអញ្ជើញគាត់ត្រឡប់មកកាន់កន្លែងផ្ដល់សាក់សីកម្មវិញនៅរសៀលនេះនៅវេលាម៉ោង 1 កន្លះហើយប្រកបអនុរ ក៏បាននាំខ្លួនគាត់ត្រឡប់ចូលរួមសកម្មភាពនៅក្នុងបន្ទប់សកម្មភាពនេះវិញនៅរសៀលនេះបានមុនម៉ោង 1 កន្លះសម្រាប់ចុះសូមជើញក្រោកចូល